So the talk will be innovation beyond technology, and I just start with categorization of innovation from very incremental, you know, it's a way to shift to breakthrough innovations that nobody will never use because it will never work. The context of this talk is as follows. You are aware that more and more resources are dedicated to research and development, but it seems that there is no real debate about the allocation of resources to research and development. It's not a matter of debate, and I'm sure, pretty sure that it will not be a part of the current debate that takes place in France nowadays. A reason is that there is a very positive image of innovation, and it does not come from nowhere. There are reasons. There is a history of the concept of innovation. A part of this talk will try, in this talk I will try to give you some insight about it. And when we talk about innovation, the image you have, maybe, is related to technological innovation. As you see, the title Innovation Beyond Technology seems to be potentially a contradiction. Innovation beyond technology, so where to innovate if it's not within the framework of technology? From an economic or macroeconomic viewpoint, from the economics of growth viewpoint, it means that the future of growth, if any, in countries like France or other OECD countries, is not so much labor or accumulation of labor or capital, but rather the technical progress part. And the domination of technology from in the conception, the discussion on innovation, is certainly the place that is given to social sciences and humanities, from now SSH, okay? So maybe I would like to ask you a first question among the one I cited here, or even if they do not appear to you, during the last 20 years, what are the most important innovations, so the ones that had the most important influence on your own life, or that changed maybe the way our societies are organized? So I just mentioned ICTs, robotics and AI, biotech and medicine. There are many, many others. I just want to get to have a short survey on your feeling. What are the most important technological innovation during the last two decades, and what are the ones that will have maybe the strongest influence in the near future? If you need chairs, maybe somebody should show you where to go, maybe. There is a space to get a chair. So, please.
Well, internet is the most obvious one, but outside, and all the ones on the list, I think, are very good. Mm. But maybe, honestly, I would have only said the list. Mm. I was trying to think beyond, and I would think lithium batteries, but maybe because everything's there.
Mm, okay. Any other view? Though it's so obvious, or it's
For me also internet, but if it can compete with, for example, the conversion of fossil fuels into mechanical work, I don't know yet.
Mm. And do you imagine what we were doing? We are not that old, but how we were working as researchers? We starting our PhDs without internet, without access to electronic resources. Can you imagine what we were doing? The time we were spending to copy books, journals in paper version. But it's our daily experience as a researcher, but of course implications go much beyond this experience. So the point is, yes, technology matters. I'm not here to tell you, forget about technology, I will tell you about the real thing. Of course it's very important. Nonetheless, we observe rising doubts about new technologies' impact of technology on well-being. And I can give you some reason of this. So the one I mentioned already is, on one side, it seems that there is no limit to the quantity of resource we can invest in new technologies. Again, there is no debate. Maybe there are some moral, ethical debate on when it concerns life, when it concerns artificial intelligence. I think it's not a public debate, but there are some debate. But then, who is really telling? Who, did you hear a voice ever saying we should restrict the resources dedicated to innovation and allocate them differently, for example, for social security schemes and so on? I try my best to hear this kind of alternative. It's very difficult to hear. Nonetheless, there is recognition that the promise of innovation, technical progress, was not always a reality, and we are living in a world with incredible possibilities from a technological viewpoint and subsistence of problems, very basic, that cannot be solved by technology. Something you should know is, of course, the contribution of technical progress or innovation to increasing inequalities. It's at least one candidate that has been well studied in the literature, and we are talking about digital gap, digital inequalities. There will be many examples. Another case is what we call plan obsolescence, and so the fact that companies have the possibility to sell on the market the wonderful technologies, but with life expectancy that will be with certain limits, and even more in some cases. There were some proofs that some companies were really able to planify the life expectancy of certain products and technologies. Then it sounds a little strange. There are various scandals, and will not enter into the detail. I will go back a little later to this point in chemical industries. You heard about things related to Monsanto, and Bayer, and other companies. And of course, because you know, you understood in the initial presentation that it will be a question of Japan, there were Fukushima. And we are somehow all concerned, maybe in Europe, within Europe, Germany and German did react much stronger than France. But from Asian and Japanese perspective, you may have intuition that it was quite important. And a part of what I will say is just a consequence of Fukushima. So let's elaborate a little on this critical discussion on innovation. One thing you should know, you should maybe keep in mind, is what the so-called Budapest Declaration. Have you ever heard about it? Budapest Declaration, 1999. So it's famous. This is, and it has, of course, a very strong influence, and it has influence on us. So when we apply, for example, to EU funding, it's partly influenced by one of the conclusions of this conference, which very easy, science in society, science for society. Yes, so what? But so what? It has not always been the case. There is a intellectual tradition saying that a good science should be outside the society. We should be not excluded from the society, but we should not be influenced by daily requests or change that are taking place every month. We are scientists. And science for society, again, you should say, yeah, well, sounds quite rational, but it has not always been the case. There is, again, intellectual traditions that say science is for science. Best discoveries were happened in a context where we were not looking for a specific application. Then application came later, but it's another story. So in 1999, during this World Science Conference, which is a gathering of scientists, of organizations in charge of administration and funding of the research. This is very representative about the problematic relationship between science and society. And at the same time, at the time we were during this World Science Conference promoting again the importance of progress, establishment of national innovation system, there was a strong discussion, strong debate on how to deal with negative consequences of technological progress. This debate was not born in 1919, of course, but it was really a starting point of a new reflection and maybe new action. So it's a way, it's a symbolic of the end of blindness. Science is wonderful. Technical progress, as we mentioned, is a source of well-being, wealth, whatever. But it has also negative consequences, and we have to take them into account. So it was the beginning for a call of a democratic debate on innovation, scientific knowledge. Did this debate really take place? I think so, but was it really public? How much did it involve the society, especially European society as a whole? This is one question we address. I will maybe not address in this presentation, but what we address in the project I will describe. Even more, maybe, so it's almost 20 years later, 2017, you know the journal Nature, famous US journal, very pro-technology, pro-innovation. And in a recent editorial, you can read the citation, the needs of millions of people in the United States are not well enough served by the agendas and interests that drive much of modern science. So it's not the scientific version of Trumpism. Don't misunderstand this sentence, but this is the recognition that there is a kind of misalignment between scientific research and needs of the society. And if it's just the daily activities of Danny and I, well, it costs a certain amount of money to the society, but it's quite minor. But in a context where we dedicate increasing and so big amount of resources to science research, I think it's time to put on the table the debate on science for whom, science for what, and science how. How do we conduct science? So why, in fact, so what I'm presenting, maybe you were aware, is based on a forthcoming book that I will introduce. And it started in 2011, the project started in 2011, and the initiative came from an organization called GST, stands for Japan Science and Technology Agency, Japan Science and Technology Agency, which is one of the key institution, funding agency, but also a research center, a little equivalent to CNRS or NSF, CNRS in France, NSF in the US. One of the most techno-centered organization. In 2000, you could read in GST report, technology will save the world. So put aside politicians, sociology, we scientists, hard science, we will save the world. And it was so shocking for them, and I will not, the purpose of the presentation is not to talk about Fukushima, but maybe there will be some question, but they went in two major directions. One, has been to promote international cooperation. They were already promoting international cooperation, but it has it's a starting point, a new wave, not only with the US, especially in many fields, but really developing international cooperation. And more related to what we are doing, creating within this institution, so-called RISTECs, no, you don't have to remember this name, but to dedicate important part of the resources of JST to social sciences and humanities. Wow. What a revolution. What a revolution, especially in a context when, maybe you heard about it, exactly at that time, government was trying to limit resources dedicated to social, especially critical social sciences within universities. Students, university students should learn something useful for their future career in companies. But there was at the same time another trend saying we should do something to develop more social sciences in relationship, of course, with sciences. So we EHSS here has been connected, CNRS, and we develop a joint program with several conferences. Major output of this book, Innovation Beyond Technology, Science for Society and Interdisciplinary Approaches. And important thing, it's really a truly international, so French-Japanese project, but truly interdisciplinary project. We have economists, sociologists, philosophers, historians, lawyers, and that's why my talk today will be maybe clearly very different from what I presented the previous year, and maybe different from what you hear in the framework of this seminar. So I don't know how it's organized this year, but at least you have read three chapters and the content of the book that I sent several weeks ago. Three chapters by one economist, Joly, French economist. Sayaka Oki is historian of thought and ideas, and Dominique Pestre is also historian of ideas, specialized in environmental issues. Today's presentation will be based on these three chapters, but also introduction that I'm writing with a colleague, philosopher Sandra Logier, and I will also refer from time to time to other chapters. I will go quickly, but just to inform you that the book has changed. I'm editing the book. I'm having a hard time, so it's my first time to present it because it's not yet finished. So it's very difficult to combine very different type of researches to make them communicating, but it's fascinating, but sometimes above my forces. The way we organize is, what I will be presenting today to introduce critical views on innovation, and to make you think about innovation from a different perspective, and to consider that what you were sure is maybe not so sure. And we have two parts dedicated, one to health and medicine issues, one to environment, and final part is asking, and I will not consider it today, just very briefly, innovation for whom, for what? So it's more, I would say, political philosophy. And if you don't know this name, thanks to the project, I got to learn her. Stéphanie Ruffy, a philosopher, wonderful, and Brice Laurent, a sociologist from Mines. So I will go back quickly to the paradox of innovation, then spend most of my time on developing a critical discussion on innovation. Give you some example of social innovation. I may cut this part if it's too long. And then, hopefully, and maybe this is here, why I hope it's meaningful for you. First, I hope it will be visible in my presentation, to experience interdisciplinary dialogue. Not always so easy, but certainly very stimulating. I hope you also will be able to discuss some critical insights on innovation, and who within the group here, who is directly doing a research connected to innovation studies, technical change, technical progress.
Raise your hands.
Three, four, yeah, okay, it's approximately like this every year. So for you, I hope maybe it might be a little moving, disturbing. And for those who are not dealing with directly with innovation issues in your own research, I still hope that you will keep in mind this discussion I would like to introduce. So back to the paradox of innovation, the initial context, very simple. More and more resources dedicated to innovation, and at the same time, rising doubts about the pertinence of investing more and more and more and more resources. Let's take some examples. You may find others, but there were some in recent years indicate some rising fears about negative implications and consequences of innovations. One is, I'm sure 99% of you are on social networks, and it changed certainly also your life, but you are aware that there are more and more questions in their impact related to news, but also related to something so fundamental as democracy, the social networks and their ability to influence the result of votes, elections. ICT, wonderful. How could we live without the internet? But what can we do with ICT? So you know the kind of fantasy regarding Big Brother, but Big Brother can become real within few years. And there is a concrete application in France, Germany, in the US, but maybe the most promising Frankenstein will be certainly in China. Through you certainly heard about facial recognition and the way citizens might be graded based on their comportment that can be followed. Because they use the information and communication technology. So well accepted acronym, but don't. Thank you for reminding me to translate it. One illusion was still 10 years ago that we are entering a digital world. It means that forget about the negative impact on the environment, forget about waste. Everything is digital. You don't, so the case for us, I'm a counter example, I still need some time to print what I'm reading, but basically you don't need to print to waste papers. But you certainly heard about the quantity of energy which is used just to make the internet function, and there are some calculations, so how much and it can be applied individually, what is the energy consumption of Professor Danny Lang, depending on the number of emails you sent yesterday, and so on. So the illusion that a digital world will not have any impact on environment and will not lead to any waste of energy is an illusion. Let's continue. So GAFAs, you know, it's a name for Google, Apple, Facebook, and Amazon. So giant companies of the industry of the ICT. And you hear about the debate that so far, and it's just a historical episode, but they manage to accumulate profits and to reduce to a point close to zero, relatively, the taxes they are paying around the world. And so they are truly global companies not paying any tax relative to their activities. Even companies with very bad reputation whose dream was not to pay tax, they never achieve what has been done by the GAFAs. taking the example of OneCast, so that you are certainly using for many purposes, Amazon, which is helping us every day, it has now a visible impact on urban, rural landscape in the US. So shops are closing. They cannot compete with Amazon. So it was true before with supermarket, and so it's all the story. But the impact of Amazon is visible in the landscape of the US, soon in Germany or in other European countries. And I already mentioned the case of plan obsolescence, which is really a kind of contradiction. Let's move to the critical discussion on what is innovation. I first start by reference to the article you read, Sayaka Oki, The History of the Concept of Innovation and its comparison with the concept of progress. First, innovation, this is an activity, but this is, after all, an ideology. And this ideology is at the same level, according to Sayaka Oki, and I'm fully convinced by what she did, at the same level that what we used to call progress. And I will discuss a little, but progress, maybe the golden age of progress in ideological discourses was, in the French context, maybe late 19th century. Or you may consider that it was rather the Enlightenment age, so rather 18th century, the idea that the humanity may face some difficulties, some people may starving, people there might be some accident, but basically the direction is very clear. The humanity is improving. Innovation is historical concept, so it's really the kind of words that you are using in your daily lives. It's used in many contexts, but you should know, and there are some research showing the use of the concept of innovation, you know, through metrics, that it started to be used instead of the concept of progress in the 80s and 90s. It corresponds, and it's a kind of paradox. We may have, so the decay of the concept of progress did not start in the 80s and 90s. I think I did not study very carefully, but I guess that the World War II had some impact on the use of the concept of progress, and I guess that the First War had certainly also some impact on the use. But according to Sayaka Oki, the real turning point is the end of the Cold War, and maybe the decay of Marxism, the grand plan for the future of the humanity, but also in a more, and I didn't recognize this as much as she described, but what we call neo-Schumpeterian research that really started in the 70s had certainly a very strong impact in the use of the concept of innovation. Just few names of what we call neo-Schumpeterian economists. Do you have any example in mind? I will not leave this room without hearing from you a name of neo-Schumpeterian economist. Don't say Schumpeter, he's not so neo. In a sense, yeah, it's a new wave of neo-Schumpeterian, but it's not enough. You cannot quit this room yet. Sorry. Again, to... No, it's not most representative. I would have two or three names that are three, please. Yes, alors, among, yeah, there is an Italian school of neo-Schumpeterian thinking. Dozzi, Giovanni Dozzi, is certainly, so. Are you Italian or? No, no, but okay. The name, so they are basically Freeman, Dozzi, Nelson, Richard Nelson in Columbia University, there are certain, there are other names, but really researchers who contributed to a great research, which has some connection with institutionalism and various school of economics, but would had also impact on policy making and maybe the way we see the world. And I did not catch this until I read and discussed with Sayaka Oki and other people. So basically, from the 90s, and so the discussion among historians, economists, to philosophers, to criticize the idea of progress, with progress with which incorporate idea of directionality, if you want, so progress of humanity, always improving, and to replace it by the concept of innovation, which as instrument, but also as a value, as a goal for society. And it's really, it has been so successful that it's no more questions. So who, do you see somebody saying, I'm against innovation, so it will be considered as a conservative or defender of reaction? And so what are the connections between the two concepts, progress and innovation? Certainly some similarities, the value of rationality, originality. Another common point which is very important is the importance of competition and the fierce competition. But what has changed with innovation, and it, again, it does not come from nowhere, maybe an idea of acceleration and some things which is more difficult to predict. In the progress, there is more idea of a structural change. It's possible to foresee in the future. In the case of innovation, attached to the concept of innovation is the idea of unpredictability and maybe discontinuity. So if I go more deeply in the description of the concept of innovation, what has been one contribution from the neo-Schumpeterian theory is to link innovation to firm behavior and to consumer needs. So in a way, and we may consider it, we may consider it as better from the viewpoint of innovation for society, because by comparison to progress that was potentially the outcome of unexpected outcome of activities of scientists that were outside the society, with the concept of innovation, it's closer to companies and hopefully to consumer needs. At the same time, the problem is it's considering citizens mainly as consumers. So if it's closer to the society, it's not closer to democracy or to people as citizens. And the big difference, and I'm taking this from a researcher, maybe you heard, US researcher, I can never pronounce his name, but fortunately it's written here, Siva Vaidyanathan, I guess. The problem is with innovation, with this fluctuation, this unpredictable nature of innovation, contrary to progress, there is maybe a lack of grand design. There is a lack of visibility of the future. And sometimes it seems that we are experiencing a cycle. This is innovation for innovation. So now I move to the contribution by Pierre Benoît Joly, so the one of the chapters of the book that was sent to you, Joly being economist, socio-economist, who specialized first in agriculture economics and who developed his thinking on innovation and technology from agriculture to other fields. So he proposed to deconstruct some myths. I will briefly review some of them. Of course, the decomposition is a little artificial, but I think there are some ideas that are quite interesting. One is the vision of trickle-down innovation. So I would like you to tell me what we call in another field the trickle-down effect. In the French context, we talk a lot about it, and it's the basis, I would say, of policy of today's government in France and maybe many other governments in the world. What do we call the trickle-down effect? Absolutely nothing to do with innovation. Huh? More, or maybe I can help. Yep. Let's try, yeah. Exactly. It will flow to the rest of the society. Exactly. Applied to the context of innovation, it's a little different, but the idea is that technology will be always, it's a faith in technology. Technology will always provide solution to our problems. And sometimes, if new problems occur because of technology, the good news is there will be always another technology to solve the problem, to kind of cycle and a very optimistic vision, sharing with liberalism, very optimistic vision. The reality is we do not have always a technology to repair the damage produced by other technologies, and there are inequalities created by innovation, and there are some problems of directionality. Let me define what we call the directionality of innovation. These are a set of questions such as, is there a good direction for innovation, and how to define this direction, and who will define this direction, and given an innovation, given a technology, how can we assess this technology, not from the viewpoint of economic value, but from the viewpoint of relation to the goal we set to the innovation. In fact, these are questions, and this is a very active research field at the crossroad between economics and political philosophy. I will not enter into discussion. Another myth, and all these myths contribute to the actual position of innovation and its problematic nature. The next myth is a linear vision of innovation. The idea that everything starts with basic science and should end with product. And you can divide the process of innovation into different parts, and again, from very basic science to technology. The reality, and so this idea is visible in some, for example, in the Lisbon Agenda, the famous Lisbon Agenda that was set by European Union. It's a way to say science is always the solution, and when we get closer to the society, we get closer to the problem. So basically the problem we have are, this is the society itself. And so you understand the relation instead between science and society. And it has been challenged long time ago by a researcher like Rosenberg, showing that scientific knowledge, applied knowledge, is a source of innovation, and this linear model is maybe verified in some very particular cases and industry, but things are much more complicated. I go quickly on this one, but this is the myth or the illusion of novelty. New technology will be always better, and it's a waste of time to spend time on old innovation and to try to improve them. This has been challenged in many respects, and this has become very popular. So I don't know if there are people interested in development economics. So these days, the concept of grassroots innovation, frugal innovation, are used in countries with very limited resources. So it's a way to apply Western developmental model to Africa, for example, and show that you can use very old mobile phone like the one I have, and to innovate without very new technologies. Very easy to understand. Next one is the idea that at the end of the day, the technology which is selected is always the best. So the market has is also very smart for technology and science. So we learn from economic and business history with researchers like David, Arthur, that small events, historical accidents, makes you using QWERTY typewriter or any other technology, not because they are the best, because we don't have the criteria for selecting the best technology, but just because they were here at the right time and used by the largest number of users. It means that technological pathways are diverse. There is no one solution to our problems. Last one, influence from neo-Schumpeterian and Schumpeterian thinking to see innovation as creative destruction. Yes, innovation may disrupt former business or former ways of doing things, but this is a precondition to establish new things. It's a kind of concept of tabula rasa. You need to destroy the past to let the economy and the society develop again. What we observe is that it's certainly true, but at the same time, as pointed out by famous economist, innovation economist, very close to Pascal Petit. I guess Pascal did gave a talk already this year. He will. So Luc Sauter, who is also a neo-Schumpeterian and who had a strong influence on the way we perceive innovation, but in a recent year he had a more critical view on his own works and shows that instead of creative destruction, we have sometimes destructive creation. An innovation that destroys more than it creates. So what to do? So I just described some negative sides. So are there any ways to get out of this vicious cycle? So what is proposed by Joly, and what is Joly being one of the contributors of the book and some of the authors of the book, there are some recommendations or conclusion of the book. One is to promote democratic innovation. And not only because democracy is good, it's not only for political value, but it allows alternative forms of innovation. And it's based on recognition that more, and I'm just citing the case of open source softwares, innovation, the divide between innovators and users is no more true and no more sustainable. The contribution of users in many respects is good for the technology itself, but it's good also for its insertion within the society. I will go back to this point, but in many cases, innovation was perceived as innovation from the viewpoint of its relationship to society. Do not worry, we are taking care of everything. We are preparing the best technology. It will arrive soon, and you will be able to use it. So a kind of disconnection between we, users, and people in charge of the innovation, people who got the resources. Next topic is what we call responsible innovation. It's becoming very popular, including at the EU level, and you have this citation, which is a form of the definition. Responsible research and innovation means that societal actors work together during the whole research and innovation process in order to better align both the process and its outcomes with the value, needs, and expectations. So society, users, they are not at the end of the process. We should find a way to put the society, including users, from a very commercial viewpoint, but society as an entity at each step of the process, and especially at the beginning, to set the priorities. The problem is, how do, it's good to say this, of course. Next step is how we do we implement this responsible and research and innovation. Final proposition is it comes from an excellent article, relatively recent article by Schott and Steinmüller, how to use science and technology policy for meeting social needs and addressing societal challenges. So far, and maybe I skipped this part, innovation was used as a local solution to larger problems. The proposition from Schott and Steinmüller, and we are trying to add something to this proposition, is not to put aside transformation of the society. Innovation cannot avoid bigger challenge at the level of society itself. Innovation, the way to see innovation as a local solution that would allow us to avoid discussing about inequalities, environmental issues, and so on, is going directly to the world. So innovation will not solve alone the societal issues, but should be at least used and put, confronted to bigger challenge. This is the message. So if I summarize the way we propose to revisit innovation, it's to downside the issue of efficiency, which is at the center of the concept of innovation, and rather to think about the distribution of agency. So to put at the center the issue of who innovates and for whom. And second message is maybe to be a little more boring, not to value necessarily what is new, but to develop a culture, a thinking of maintenance, repair, recycling. Not only recycling a pet bottle, but recycling ideas, devices, phones, whatever. Let me, so now I guess I have 15 minutes approximately?
No, maybe nine.
Okay, so I got some. Okay, perfect. So I will, we are using various, we started a little late, but okay, I can adapt, no problem. 9 minutes, you cannot see, but I'm half Japanese, and my relationship to the time, even if it was not visible at the beginning of the seminar, is very strong. So in the book, we have several examples of what could be social innovation, an innovation that certainly rely on technology, but not only. And there is this chapter that I will not discuss, I hope we can discuss later, by Dominique Pest, showing that basically, so far, the best innovation in the field of environment were not technical, but rather legal, social. Just let me introduce the Japanese experience. And Japan is a very strange country. It's one of the most techno-center country, you see technology everywhere, and you can imagine Japanese engineers spending, there is a word for this, otaku, people are crazy about technology, they are exciting, they are getting wet when they have a new product and so on. At the same time, when you look at the reality, when you look at the contribution of Japanese companies, it was not so much technological, it was more much more human than what you can see. Let me develop the case of so-called Toyotism, the case of Toyota. Things are very simple. We found in late 80s, early 90s, that systematically Toyota plants were more productive than US and European competitors. First hypothesis has been This is certainly because of robotics. And it's true, they use a lot of robots. Another hypothesis was mechanization. And some of the people, another name that you should remember, Coria, Benjamin Coria, has been one of the economists. We said, no, I don't think it's so much mechanization. It should be something else. And he, with others, found that Toyotism, I do not advise you to work for Toyota. It's hard and it's painful. But the way they improve their productivity is not so much with their robots, but it's really grassroots innovation. Maybe you have, so the way they improve their productivity is thanks to Mr. Tanaka, who found a better way than I did to connect this computer to this. No, nothing incredible. It's daily innovation. It's grassroots innovation. And it's to put blue-collar workers at the center of the innovation process. So there is no gap, like in France typically, between super-class, A-class engineers and what they consider as being D-class blue-collar workers. Innovation is done on the ground. And this is what we can learn from Japan. Unfortunately, Japanese companies have lost this sense, and they have engaged themselves in a technological rest, meaning that, as you know, Japan is a country where the ratio of R&D expenses to GDP is the highest in the world. So we look at the input, but when you look at the output of this, you're not always impressed. And you see here that 20 firms are gathering more than 50% of the spending of R&D. The case is Sony. So we should learn, Sony for you, maybe it disappears. I don't think one of you has a Sony product, but our generation, we dreamed about Sony. We were Sony, we had...
don't forget the PlayStation.
PlayStation, yes. I forgot, my son is not, he's too young to use that PlayStation, but nonetheless, clearly everybody agrees that in many sectors, dimensions, Sony had the best technology. Just the problem, at some point, they lost their connection with the user, and they lost even a sense of serving the society. They were, it became, on one side, a technological company and a marketing company. And Sony maybe was close to disappear, maybe PlayStation has saved us, but you have example of a company with the best technology, by far, but which is disconnected from users and also citizens, the use of people. You have a question? No? No, I thought you want to have to address the case of Sony, but maybe later. So to conclude in 3 minutes, and maybe I hope also some lessons for you as a young social scientist. Don't forget, please don't forget, and this is also one message of Epoch, that economics is a social science. Which position for social sciences and humanities in this revised, in the new context for innovation and technology? What is sure is that we should not use social sciences to make technical progress more acceptable. The idea that scientists have the truth, they know where they go, and citizens do not know, and we should use social sciences just to make new technology more acceptable. It's not democratic. It's a very strange vision of the society, but also from the pure view of innovation, it's not good. It's not a way to innovate. So the connection, how to take into account the human factor. The starting point of this reflection is to consider that there is always a gap between the perfect technology on one side as it came out from the lab and its use in the society. And there are many examples. I'm the base case for this. The number of options you have on your smartphone and the number of options you use, or the way you reinvent through your use the technology. So how you accommodate the technological change through your practices and so on. And social sciences should put this human factor at the center of the collaboration between science and humanities and social sciences. It will be my last word. Social sciences also should help to identify what is the ultimate criterion for innovation. And this ultimate criterion should be well-being. How much this innovation in the short run, the mid run, or the longer run will improve our collective well-being or individual well-being, but also will reduce inequalities. And so how it can help, in the best innovation should help us to mitigate inequalities produced by other mechanisms. This is certainly the role that can be used, that can be played by social sciences, and I will be very, very pleased with you to discuss this proposition. So science for society, science with society, so it's participation level, and science by society. It means social innovation. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, Professor Le Chevalier, thank you very much for your very insightful and inspiring presentation, I would say. So Arnaud, Sophia, and me will give you a 15 minutes response presentation to this. And before the content, the structure, I personally would say that asking what science is and what science is for, and situating the role of innovation in that process remains very important today, not only because of the catastrophe in Fukushima, for example, or the rising environmental pressures, but also because also at the European level, for example, nowadays we have that shift after the Framework Program 7 of scientific research funding from the framework programs towards one more mission-oriented approach to science that was maybe more from the United States. So there is something changing, and I think it's an interesting moment to talk about that. Today we will speak about, well, first of all, some conceptual issues about innovation and technology that we found good and where we had to criticize something in the texts. I will continue with revealing the mainstream, more economic paradigm of technological innovation. Sophia will continue with going on the social innovation part beyond technology. And Arnaud will very relevantly, I think, ask the question and the relationship to the growth paradigm and what the actual problem is.
Don't forget to introduce which countries. Okay.
Yes, it's good for me because I don't know you.
So. Sure. Okay, so I'm from Germany, mm-hmm. Sophia is from Sweden, and Arnaud from Canada, Quebec. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So yes. Just to speak about innovation, so the authoritative source, I think we can say, is Schumpeter and maybe also the OECD is saying innovation. Okay, it comes from creative destruction, but nowadays relates to marketization of kind of new or substantially improved products, processes, also organizational issues. And then in the text of Jolie, the kind of vision is to go to an innovation that is balanced with an idea of continuity, of recycling, of maintaining and repairing. So I think there the conceptual grounds are quite clear, where do we depart from, where do we want to go. For technology, we found it was a bit less clear. Because there is also extensive strands on literature on what is conceived as technology, and okay, sure, and yes. So, for example, is technology only a set of use-oriented artificial objects, artifacts, or object systems, as the German Association of Engineers, for example, defines it? Is it more, can we also see it more as a, like from a sociological perspective that technology actually shapes and embodies social relationships and is just a way in which we connect, relate to the world, and through which also power relations play a role? So I think here we would like to have you, like, your idea on what technology we want to talk about. And yeah. Yes.
Like, I think division one would say that innovation is an object, whereas point one would be that innovation is an object, maybe, and point two would be that innovation can be anything, not only an object that you can sell, but also a social structure or a social or a political innovation.
Okay. So now the mainstream paradigm of technological innovation. So we decided to start from the iPad equation, which for in economics has been quite influential, also not without controversy, where you kind of see impacts very blatant, like broadly as a function of population, their affluence, and the technology that a society adopts. And then that this impact kind of, as population controls are usually undebatable as much as the lifestyle for many, reducing the impact can only be achieved through the T, through the eco-efficiency strategies. And from this kind of idea, like all these narratives of green growth, the techno-optimism, I mean, in the text of Julie, it is depicted almost as a religion, which I think is true in many cases, that technology replaces the void that religion or our like non-religious kind of life anymore. So so this is where it kind of comes from, and then we see that the dematerialization hopes that many had have not materialized. Planetary boundaries continue to be transgressed. Economic growth has not achieved to decouple from material energy throughput for a variety of reasons, just because technological innovations most of the time are complementary to an existing basket of goods and services. And that's just one reason. Another reason is there are the rebound effects. So just briefly, like if there's an efficiency gain, for example, for the price of electricity, the production of electricity, the price will drop. And then the rebound effect would be an increase in demand of it. So a situation where in the end, despite the efficiency gain, you consume more of it. So these are the criticisms. And
T is improving, but A is going up. So more than T is improving. So in the end, our impact is still big.
Yeah.
And assuming that we don't want to touch A, because A is like production and consumption in society, so it's like
growth, and like as a capitalist society, we don't want to touch that. That's like essential. So then we're gonna focus on P population, maybe not realistic. We're gonna focus on T. T is like making everything more efficient, so that we can have just as much as before, produce just as much, but maybe destroy less the planet.
Hmm. I won't go into the five myths of innovation anymore. I think you explained them quite clearly. This is where we kind of see this urgent need to not only challenge the vision and the role of technology for innovation, but also our idea of sustainability, because most of the times it's only focused on efficiency and not on sufficiency or on consistency. And kind of to adopt these points of view, is very important when talking about the sustainability of innovations, whether they are technological or other in their nature. And with these words, I give the microphone to Sophia.
Yes. So I think we now kind of established that technology is not the solution for everything, especially not these major challenges. And I think the last reading that we had very much emphasize this in relation to these environmental challenges that we have, and explain this, as Professor mentioned before, that it's rather these political, economic, or legal tools that we use that has improved it, while this is just these tools are kind of aimed towards controlling these negative side effects from this technology. So it's definitely important to reevaluate the role of technology, since these changes or control methods or tools, they haven't really been material or technical in nature. So in addition to that, these tools that we have used, they haven't been enough, and they haven't really approached or solved the issue that we're having with environmental issues, but also innovation in a broader sense of having this, what we see as innovation, as more well-being and such, and we've just seen more this negative impact on redistributive effects. So Haxeltine et al, they also wanted to introduce what they said, and they said that this systemic change and societal challenges that we have, they actually emphasize this role of different types of innovation, social innovation being one of them. And he saw this rather as a bottom-up approach, where we have these new forms of ownership, new lifestyles, consumer habits, and new productive methods. And the question is, of course, then how to implement it. And I just wanted to show kind of a graph that he or they had in their paper, which is kind of this, have these new forms of ways of these social innovations, how they're produced. And that we see that these different, like economic crisis, climate change, ICT revolutions, they're just challenging that we're facing. And we cannot really solve these without also including this bottom type and this social part of it. And which is also then what Jolie, what he emphasized in his paper, that innovation itself is social technical. It cannot just be one part separate from another. And I think that we can also see that in this part, that we have the technological part in one sense, but we have the challenges in other parts, and how to connect them is probably through like social innovations or other types of innovations. And since we realize now that just this at itself, it won't really solve these other parts. So I did find this picture interesting, and I think that Joel is, he, as we also heard before, he presented these three literature streams of how to reinvent innovation and how to have these innovative policies. First of all, this democratizing innovation. I'm just going to go quickly because we already talked about this a bit, but having this community-based and distributed sources of innovation, since there cannot only be one source of innovation. The second one was this responsible innovation. We have to align the different technology or the different developments within science with what society needs. So not being profit oriented, but more oriented towards what the science society is asking for. So to have this transformative change and deep changes, we have this combination between this type of developments or challenges. And I think an important thing that he mentioned, or they mentioned, was that it may require these asymmetries of power or in resources, because we may need this different types of experimentation to ensure this diversity. Because just as innovation once started at a small scale and had to be diffused to have other solutions or even exit from certain innovations that appear not to be good at the end, we need this outnovation, which might need then defusion instead of diffusion, and these experiments can kind of help with that and at least try different options. So including the social is definitely an important part of it, but this also emphasized that the technology still kind of has a role and can have a role. It has these opportunities for social innovation, at least, because we have these radical new ways of sharing experience to interact, especially across borders, and to mobilize these different types of knowledge or experiences. So I know you mentioned this, like open source software and like hacker spaces. We have the sharing economy platforms that helps people interact towards achieving these new ways of organizing. But we also have to look at this type of creative or destructive creation, as they call it. But what about innovation driven by old technologies? Is that not innovation anymore because we've gone back to something because the new thing to turn out not to be good. No, it's probably innovation as well, even if we go back to something. So I think we have to rethink this concept of innovation as it's not something new. I think that's very much focused on the new part of it, but new can also be old that can be reintroduced. But
it has to be better, not new. Because new is going to lead us to consume more, even if it's not better. It's the same, it's just as bad, but it's a new product. No.
Yeah. I agree with you. I do. One question I did want to ask, though, is that I want to see if innovation is becoming too dependent on technology, as if we cannot innovate without technology. Whether it's social innovation, innovation for environmental changes, do we still need technology always to interact? And if that case, are we very limited, or could we be limited if certain interactions or such are controlled by big platforms as Amazon or similar? So I will leave the floor to Anon.
Like you were saying, maybe technology will make food producing more efficient, but we're not going to eat technology. To go back to the last thing you said, I think Sofia did a very good job at summarizing what we could learn from the paper, and even more, like the question that were arising from it. I'm going to try to recap it, maybe just louder, and also go to highlight a question that I had, trying to frame the whole chapters in a simple way. So they're elaborating the potential solution to the problem we're facing of unsustainable development. The solutions are first. So the main question that was arising to me is the problem growth or innovation? Because in the paper, we seem to have these two problems, and I was wondering what's the link, and like. The paper is about innovation, but growth really seems to be the problem. So how can we think about all of that? So here I'm summarizing the paper and answering that question. The solutions that we have right now are innovation, first and foremost. And then we have other sorts of solutions, like economic compensation, rules by the state, the market, like cap and trade. Voluntary is just like corporate social responsibility. And denial is just like, oh, there's no problem. And then what is the result? The result is that regarding innovation, the problems are multifaceted. We have a legal problem, political problem, social problem, but technological, the solution is only technological. How can the solution be only technological when the problem is so multifaceted? All right, this is regarding to innovation. And then regarding all the other solutions, and this I will have to use the quote because it's very interesting, basically the gap between claim and results, we're not solving the problem. And here, the key reason being the unwillingness to alter growth and development, to transform our modes of production and our way of life. We do not want to abandon our carbonated and polluting trajectory, and growth remains our god. So really here, the problem seems to be growth. So I was like, is the problem innovation or growth or both? What's the link between the two? Looking at the solutions that are proposed in opposition to the solutions that did not work, we have the three solutions that we listed before. And when we look at the relation from one to the other, that's how it becomes clear, the relation between innovation and growth. Here, democratizing innovation. I have useful notes, I will use them. If it's democratized, it means that we're considering the interest of everyone and not just the interest of the captains of industry or the capitalists, the ones who do the investment. Them, their goal is to do profit. But as a society, our goal is to save the planet, let's put it simply. So if the process of innovation is not democratic, the result will not favor the majority. So if we democratize, then we can obtain, this is why we have an arrow, responsible innovation, where the innovation is aligned with social need instead of just profit and profit making and capitalist needs. And then if we have this democratic innovation, maybe innovation will go beyond technology and we will consider that the solution is not an object that you're going to sell and make profit. Maybe the solution will not imply you making profit, but maybe the solution will imply actually solving the fucking problem. Sorry, solving the problem. So we will have innovation that is aligned with the needs of society. And so we will say maybe we need not technological progress, but social progress or political progress. And that's where we get to transformative change. And I guess this transformative change
We see it. The paper is talking about the problem that the global race to the bottom of capitalism, the global capitalism race to the bottom, is the problem and is the transformative change that we have to operate. So in the end, is the main problem growth or innovation? The problem is growth or the race to the bottom of global capitalism. This is not according to me, according to the paper. So the solution needs to be social, political, economical, and legal. But since everybody thinks innovation is the solution, either we include social changes in innovation and not strictly conceive innovation as technological innovation, or if we don't want to consider political change as innovation, we will have to do away with the idea that innovation is the only solution. That's it. I hope it's clear.
We have just some discussion questions.
So this is to all of you. So how can we achieve that, what in the paper they call the Copernican revolution in innovation studies, from this innovation notion centered around novelty and creative destruction, to one that is actually working within the safe operating space of planet Earth, within the planetary boundaries, centered around continuity? And what are like concrete solutions for, but how can we, for example, incentivize companies to adopt such a model of innovation?
Yeah, because basically looking for solutions, right?
Yeah,
concrete. The solutions that are listed are the three solutions that we've seen and seem to be framed in the Copernican revolution. This Copernican revolution is maybe the solution englobing like all of this. But we are looking for something concrete. But maybe this concrete is in, I think, some part that I saw there. One part of the book seems to include, just judging by the title, because I only had access to the title, seems to include a potential solution. So basically, we're just curious about concrete solution.
Mm-hmm. OK, thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
It's up to you to respond.
Yes, I would like to engage a little in a discussion, and then we have time with the rest. So I won't be too long, but thank you very much. And it comes at a stage when our introduction is not finalized, and I took this presentation as a first, again, you know, a first way to receive feedbacks and try to improve the. Our message, the readability of our message. I would be glad to receive your presentation, and I will be glad also to send you a copy of the book when it's published. So please send me your emails and any contact. Of course, I can send it to Danny, but I'm not sure he will forward it to you. He may keep it. Yes, of course. Let me try. So to maybe not to answer by point, maybe to clarify a part of the message, and at the end to go to the question of solutions. So first, I think our intention is not to say that innovation is finally limited to the destruction part. And so we want to keep the positive meaning of innovation as there was a very positive meaning of progress. So you may disagree or not with the idea that the humanity is progressing. You may criticize, as we are doing, it will be the second part of my answer, about the way we innovate. But to build together a society that continue to move forward, that contribute to solve social problems, this is what our intention. But what we try to do is to try to mitigate some limitation or to discuss the very meaning of innovation or certain approach of innovation. Quickly on the definition of technology, if you can go back to your slide. Well, it's true we did not discuss, and typically this is what I should somewhere add. It's not discussed so much in any of the chapters. Maybe it's not the core message of the book, but it's good to clarify. The core of the book is to discuss the relationship between, say, technology and society, but it's true that we have to clarify. Maybe what we have in mind is to criticize, maybe it is, I think it's your second approach, or the first? No, the first one, so to see the technology as what we call in France techniques, and so ways of doing. At the same time, there is also maybe an approach of technology which is not fully satisfying that we'd call social technology, so I think we are maybe not everybody in the book, but at least in the approach we have, I think, in common with Danny and other colleagues at CEPN, is to develop an approach of institutions that are not social technology. Institutions are political compromise. Mm-hmm. So it's another dimension. All of you mentioned the issue of sustainability, and especially you emphasize very much the chapter by Pestre, and this is, as you understood, a chapter that I did not discuss so much. Also, I think it's very important. There are several interesting ideas in this chapters. One is that, this is what you said. Technology has never been the solution to environmental issues. It could be, and this morning, in fact, I was visiting a French company called Air Liquide, and they are trying, so they are developing gas, they are selling gas to various industries, but they are also trying to innovate from a very technological perspective to identify ways, to capture CO2 and to, when you capture, so it's a way to reduce CO2 emission and to, it's a technological solution to environmental issue. But this solution, and the guy I met was agree, is not sustainable. So at the end, the issue, and this is the second result, so the first result was at the end, technology is not the solution. They are non-technological solution. But what Pestre is insisting on is the idea that there is no way to overcome the trade-off between growth and the environment. Whatever you do, we will face some limitations. So his thinking is very much in the tradition of Club de Rome, growth limitation and so on. So I'm not sure that the goal of everything we are doing is growth. The goal of what we are doing is well-being. And if growth can help, and I would never go as far as Pestre is doing, contributing or to development economics. We should never forget, so for countries I know a little, we should never forget what growth did for a country like South Korea. South Korea in the 50s was one of the poorest country in the world and became one of the most affluent with its own problem, and technology and growth created a lot of problem of Korea. But to see the trajectory of very poor East Asian economies and what they could achieve, I would never neglect the potential contribution of growth. But growth has only a tool at some point to improve well-being. If growth is the cost of growth is higher, or if the cost among some categories of citizens is higher, then we should have a debate. So definitely, the goal is not growth. Growth is a tool, and technological innovation at some point can be a tool. What
he seems to say that growth is the problem, not the solution.
Alors, Pestre. To Pestre, growth is a problem. I disagree with this, and he is forgetting the contribution of economic growth to the fight against poverty and so on. Then, There are some, maybe PESP will answer, but okay, but you look in the medium run, in the long run. The key question is the planet Earth and what we do. And we already reach a period, a stage, which is too late to let the humanity survive so we can engage in this kind of situation. From economic perspective, alors, let's call it the medium term, to me, economic growth in a very restrictive sense has been an incredible, unique tool to fight against poverty, to develop societies, and sometimes to contribute to democracy. But it cannot be a goal per se, and in many cases, where the growth model is reaching its limit. I'm not talking in terms of slowdown of growth, but negative impact of growth. There was another idea in your excellent presentation, is the idea of how sometimes technology or new technology can be an impediment to innovation. And maybe it's good that you experience this already. How technology can help you to reach articles or to connect with your family, your friends, to meet people you would have no chance to meet, but also how it can be an impediment to invent by yourself, to develop solutions that do not require technology. And maybe this is, you don't have the full picture, but this is said a little by Pierre-Benoît Joly, but I think we could even develop, it's not only innovation beyond technology, but really, sometimes again, technology as an impediment to innovation at the service of human well-being. solution. What are our solutions? So, maybe it's all our responsibility to propose solution. You will, in some chapters, maybe I can cite some of them, see what you call some concrete solution. And I love this call for concrete solution. It's not enough to say, you see innovation, it might be good, no good, we don't know. No, it's really where we go, what we do. But it's true, also, we are not the first one. It's not the first book, and I was glad that you took some other references, that there were many contributions on social innovation already. I would say that the stage, I think the way I see this book is nonetheless before proposing solution, and I will give you some that are presented in the book. I think when you look at the way innovation is perceived, when you look at the way we live in this techno-centered society and vision of innovation, I think it's not waste of time to spend time, as I did, I hope you did not waste your time this afternoon, to discuss, to have a critical look at what we call innovation. Without proposing a very concrete solution to the well-being of innovation, to take time, to stop for a while, and to think together of what we call innovation. So, I think it's a first contribution. The second stage, and this is proposed among others in the chapter of Joly, is to propose redirection of innovation, to put additional condition to what we call innovation. So the way we innovate, the direction of innovation, the purpose of innovation, they are not concrete solution, but again, before going to the concrete solution, also there is a time to say innovation for whom, for what, and how. Next, solution. So, frankly speaking...
Question one and question two first. What is innovation? Right now, innovation is very much conceived, as we were saying in the beginning, as a product. And if we want to reconceive what is innovation, I think from the paper is what the author wants to convey is that we need to include social and political change and all sort of processes in innovation. Innovation is, to put it simple, anything that makes our life better. Whereas right now, innovation is
anything that will allow me to make a profit and that people are going to want to buy.
Alors, exactly. Alors, you're going a little too far, but it's true that there is this distinction, and maybe so Jolie is doing it well, the other chapters are doing. So concept of innovation as a tool for competition. To innovate or to perish, innovation as a tool for companies to differentiate. This is the, at some point, innovation is an alternative tool to marketing. You can spend money in marketing or in technological innovation. The goal is the same, is to differentiate from others. So we are not talking about this kind of innovation. Again, is innovation as a tool to improve well-being. I agree with this point, and again is to revitalize this idea of progress, but with a different meaning and with a different agenda. Concrete solution, just one point. So just one example, one of the chapters by Gaudière, he's a sociologist of medicine. He studied a lot in India, and the starting point in the chapter and in his research is what we call the crisis of pharmaceutical industries. The pharmaceutical industries are engaged in a race to innovate. Companies, maybe you heard about Sanofi, a very famous French pharmaceutical company. They got their best sellers. They will fall into the public domain. That should be a good news for everybody. This is not a good news for them. And they are spending a lot of money to invent the next best-seller drug that makes their profit. So it's typically the innovations in the sense one, innovate to make profit. And Gaudière is discussing alternative medicine, invented, developed, especially in India. There are also other cases in Africa. Medicines that are rediscovered, that are developed, sometimes at industrial level, but that were kind of grassroots innovation. This is not medicine in the sense of your grandmother when she advised you to eat lemon in the morning and something. It's something more sophisticated. It has chemical properties, but it's found in the nature. And the kind of solution is proposed is to to have a democratic discussion that would lead to a rehabilitation of this kind of traditional medicine, closer to the society, closer to the tradition, but it's not a value per se, it's closer to the well-being of people and with less resources spent for a purpose that goes in a different, that contributes certainly to well-being, but that are not only related to well-being. So it's a kind of concrete solution. How to rehabilitate traditional medicine in a country like India, how to give it the way to compete with medicine as sold by pharmaceutical multinational. So maybe it's disappointing for you. It's not a localized solution, but at least it opens some political space. And it's a well-identified object of discussion that may contribute to improve well-being.
You would never say it explicitly, sorry. But it seems like...
I know this is bringing a lot of discussion, is great, but we're democratizing, so yes, we're going to open up the floor for questions.
Good, thank you.
Anyone who wants to ask a question? Okay. I think I will start by here. I will write everyone's. Is it okay for you if you take three at a time?
Yeah. Many. Okay. It's time is flying.
So we'll start with Francie, Isabel, and then Jan. And don't forget to
introduce your name and the country you come from.
Hello, my name is Franziska. I'm from Italy, and I'm from Option A, Innovations and Knowledge. And I have a question because I am doing my thesis on biotechnology in agriculture, and I encountered that those biotechnologies are posing some problems for food security. And the biggest problem I saw was in the IPRs, the intellectual property rights, because they pose high entry costs for innovators to enter the market. They're also very privative and not inclusive and very profit driven. So that's why it's really hard for, as you mentioned before, in the pharma industry, for grassroots innovators to enter the market. So I wanted to have your opinion on that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Isabel Borja. I come from Ecuador. And my option is also acknowledge and innovation policies. And I was wondering, to what extent do you think the social component of innovation could be introduced in the social, in innovation policy? Like, this relates a little bit to IPR and, yeah, patents and, but also in how we define R&Ds and, yeah, and the other question that I have is, how do you think this innovation paradigm that is not focused on social innovation, is mostly in profit and appropriability, could relate also to how we educate ourselves, like how education relates to this paradigm of innovation?
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Jan. From Argentina, also option A. Thank you for your presentation. I found it really stimulating. Related to the science for what and whom, I agree on the social need orientation of science. And I wanted to ask you about the role of university within this social orientation of science in the allocation of resources from one side, because you said that maybe basic science should not, or that we should direct resources to topics related to society, and maybe basic science is more about serendipity. So if we should allocate less resources towards basic science, and second, about the management of the integration process of universities, towards the private sector and also society, how shall we make universities get into play in their relationship with society and universities, with a conflict of privatizing knowledge, maybe like using patents? About, if you can give some words about it, I would appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, first and then there is a second one. Okay, okay. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. So thank you very much. So first, it's for the first question, very, very simple. So we should recognize, of course, that if we, if innovators or if inventors are not protected, given the nature of knowledge as a public good, it will decrease, so it's the premise of increasing IPR is correct, I think. If we don't protect inventors, we decrease the incentive for them to make effort, to dedicate resources for to increase the knowledge. So this kind of way of thinking is acceptable in the first step. At the same time, the way the type of innovation concept we are proposing, you see that the issue of IPR for the kind of social innovation is a perfect contradiction. The social innovation is open innovation. So the more you protect, the less you allow for diffusion of innovation. So I would say, I will never deny the importance of technological innovation, of developing new type of, to let biotech develop. what we should sure is that it's at the service of the well-being of the society. So it's a matter of balance. And when I'm teaching economics of innovation in standard classes, I just mentioned the trade-off between protection of inventors and diffusion of technology, and a negative side of higher IPR would be decrease the possibility of innovation. In the context of this presentation, where we had a second layer of criticism, we should really question even more the way we have developed a model of innovation with a stronger intellectual property right, which is apparently not so much at the service of the society, but which is a guarantee to protect future profit. So your question is very relevant. How to introduce social innovation in social in innovation policy? Well, I think there is really it's a key concern. So you see what I show: Budapest conference, the way EU tried to incorporate responsible innovation, the way what are their tools to take into account social innovation. Unfortunately, I have no. Very simple answer to your question. I think it's a key challenge, and it's like I see there is a form of bipolarity in the science and technology policy in the EU. They incorporated this critical thinking, and in a sense they are clearly much advanced than their Japanese counterpart, and sometimes much advanced than in the US. But in then the kind of lesson they draw from this critical thinking is quite problematic, and I cannot cite very simple, concrete example of innovation policies that really take seriously the critics that seems to be incorporated in the discourses. I would like to invite some EU officer here, but so it's excellent question, and to work in this direction is, I think, very necessary. Excellent question, but with different dimensions. One, I would start with a first point as follows: the conclusion of what we said, we are trying to say in this book, is we should stop sponsoring support. We should stop our support to basic science, and we should focus only on very applied technology and so on. And so the criticism is again the techno-centered paradigm, but I don't have immediately a concept of basic social innovation, except maybe what we may call the surrounding innovation, so democratic innovation that would not help immediately to improve the well-being, but would contribute to a more democratic life. So it would be a kind of basic innovation, so not improving directly your well-being. But don't misunderstand our purpose. It's not to downgrade basic innovation. It's to introduce more social concern in the basic science. And I don't know when Marie Curie made her research, was she aware about what could be done, dramatically bad things that could be done based on her discovery, would have stopped her research in thinking about the application. I do not know, but at least to address this question, to make our scientists to have an additional requirement for our scientists to have education in ethics, in sociology, in not to disconnect science and science within society is at least a first step. The role of universities, it's also a very good question, but I would say it's a different questions. So you did not ask one question, but two or three. And I would say a part is the role of the government. It's a part, it's a really a political decision. And for a part, it's the way universities are managed. And as far as I'm concerned, I would tell it's just a concrete, very concrete example, but important for me. This school, École des hautes études en sciences sociales, officially is built for the society. But look where we are. And our geographical situation makes very clear that we are open to anybody. Anybody can attend our seminar. So the way we function is different from EPOG. There is no entrance exam. But also we have our own student, master student, coming from everywhere, also Latin America, Africa, sometimes Japan. We have people coming from outside the HSS. They don't have to pay any subscription fee to attend our seminars. But this category, in 90% of the case, they are in their late 70s and they are living around in the 7th or 6th arrondissement. This is not exactly the type of society we are studying, paradoxically, in our class of critical sociology, Bourdieu style. And I really hope that when this school will move to Condorcet campus, which is north of Paris, Aubervilliers, outside the peripheric, some of my colleagues never went outside the peripheric.
You know where it is.
Exactly. Huh? So we will be closer to Danny and his colleagues. Let's see. I really hope we will do a different science and we will really attract people that might be directly concerned by what we call critical social. So it would be maybe a very small contribution, but at the level of EHSS, it might be a revolution.
So next three questions, Francesca,
okay.
And then Yannick and Dure.
Okay.
Yannick and Dure?
No. Oh, sorry. Yannick?
Thank you for your talk. My name is Yannick. I'm from Germany, and I'm in the track for development economics. So I don't know a lot about innovation or the economics of innovation. However, I also want to talk a little bit about who is innovating and for whom, especially. You raised that point. So I know this viewpoint of Mariana Mazzucato, like that she's arguing, okay, the state by itself is actually a big innovator. Like what? Was state in my mind was, for example, the GPS thing that all of we are using. My question is basically, so what is the role of the state, in your opinion, by starting innovations, but also by directing innovations, and by maybe redistributing the outcome in that sense that I mean, all the GAFAs have huge revenues, and the status and the taxpayers are not really profiting from these huge revenues. Yeah.
Excellent question.
Hi, my name is Tore. I'm also from Germany and also from Track C. So my state of knowledge on innovation economics is quite similar to Yannick's.
Which is good.
So maybe lower. My question goes in the direction of Isabel's on the education of technology, and I wonder, because we talk a lot about democratization of the process, but I wonder if the if a democratic process is able to assess all of the impacts of technological innovations, and if it's not necessary to start, like by now, to start in school with like having an own subject which covers not only the use of technology, but like socio-philosophical and ethical issues that come along with innovations, as well as maybe like a bridge to psychology, and I wonder if these parts are also covered in the book, because I think like, yeah, I don't know a lot, but in my bachelor we had like a sociologist who did like a socio-psychology study on the transformation of society through technological innovations. I can't, it was in German, so I can't really translate it, but it basically was about the ever faster growing society and how our societal surrounding gets way more complicated, but basically the time of the day stays the same, and what that means for our life.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your presentation. I'm Francesco from Italy, option A, knowledge and innovation. What I wanted to ask you, if maybe if you can spend some more words in maybe defining the main pillars of this social innovation, because what the definition seemed to me, it's like keeping these both social and technical dimension of it. But what came up to my mind, it's a concept used in Marxist political economy of non-neutrality of technology. And like, I was thinking that this concept of social innovation can be really powerful to bring inside the innovation debate the importance of social needs, but at the same time, there's a risk of falling in the same rhetorical trap of like still giving this importance to innovation. So what's the difference of a social innovation? Isn't it just social change that we need in a way?
Mm. Okay. Thank you. Alors, starting, so role of the state. So I come, so I was in my education, in my research, I studied the role of developmental state. I studied the role of the government in Japan, in development, in promoting innovation. I studied the same case in Korea. So I'm quite convinced that the government can play a role in the innovation as technological development, technological catch-up. I don't know if you're aware of the work also of a Korean professor called Kun Lee. Kun Lee, Lee is L-E-E, so a specialist of catch-up, catch-up economy. So clearly, the government in the past, and especially in the East Asian context, showed that he had the capacity to give orientation to help the technological choice. These days, there is objection that is really the government able to understand the technology, to know which technology is the best and so on. Clearly not, but what we should be aware, and again, in discussing with people from the company I mentioned, Air Liquide, or company called Orange, maybe you have, coming to France, you were forced to subscribe to Orange. When we discuss with business people, what is interesting is most of them, they have absolutely no idea about the direction of technology and so on. So it's going too fast and it's too much unpredictable. So nobody knows, and still the state might be in a position to let people discuss, to converge, and to be a kind of referee to select different between different options. But what I understood in what I took from your question is what the state did in the past in terms of choice of technologies, and saying that we Korean government, we target the development of devices, and we want Samsung to become the number one in the world and so on. The government, if what we said is correct, the government can even play a bigger role in terms of social innovation, but in the meaning of setting the priorities for and with the society. So we have clearly a problem of profit-led innovation and well-being-led innovation. I'm not saying that no company, we cannot believe in any company in making profit and improving well-being. History shows that sometimes it's possible to make profit and to increase the well-being of consumer, but it's not always the case, and government can really play a role for this type of innovation and using the same type of policies through regulation, subsidies, and so on. So I would really emphasize this role. Second question, I'm not sure I fully understand, but I would say, so what I understood is the problems, the kind of problem we have with this kind of discussion is, okay, let people contribute to innovation, let people choose the technology, do not let only Amazon and Apple choose what will be our life next. Yes, but I'm just sorry, I had no technical education, or I have a technical education, but I didn't have a philosophical education. So what should we do? There is one chapter that I did not show in this book. I should confess that I really, it was my first time really to engage in this kind of discussion. So the name I mentioned, Stéphanie Ruffy, she is a political philosopher, French political philosopher, R-U-P-H-Y, discussing the epistemological, she's not telling you that Mr. Martin in the street, you just take him in the room and he will tell you what is what should be innovation in the 21st century, what should be the investment and so on. But she's trying to connect, related to one of the previous questions, how we can create institutional framework through in which citizen with certainly a better education, more complete education, will have a better understanding of the issues at stake in terms of innovation, progress, technological development, and how scientists should incorporate the voice of citizens, the requirement of citizens, including in their basic research. It's not to connect nuclear physics to my problem of legs, but it's just to take into consideration to learn how to take into consideration the voice of the society. As for the last question, I would understand, I will interpret your question as follows. What we describe here is a way to innovate that tries to put aside the issue of transformation of the society. It's kind of division, as I said previously, between social problems that would be in the responsibility of government, political arena, and technology, which is something different, and there is no class issues, there is maybe illusions that technology is neutral. This is just science. Nothing to do with class society, with inequalities. I'm just doing my research for the best science. So I agree that we may, and Stéphanie Ruffy again is also referring to this discussion, that in fact science is not neutral, technology is not neutral, and maybe also through education, democratic debate, scientists should really take seriously social problems, and we should really build a bridge, or convince them that it's necessary to build a bridge between scientific activities and society as it is, not to have a cut between these two issues. Shall we?
Huh? I mean, it's 5 past. So Unless there is a very urgent question.
I will be very pleased to continue the discussion with, maybe not today, I have another class just after, but don't hesitate to send me an email. Really, again, thank you to the three coordinators and discussants. Thank you to Danny for having asked me to participate. And I really hope that this kind of discussion, which is not finished, far from being finished, can be a source of discussion for all of you, whatever your precise research topic is. So thank you.